Hello, and welcome to the League of Women Voters Presents. I am Bill Litvin, your host for this program on the Chesapeake Bay. I would like to introduce my first guest. Carin Bisland is Chief Partnerships and Accountability Branch EPA Chesapeake Bay Program Office. That is a mouthful, Carin. Yes, welcome.
Thank you. I thank you and the League of Women Voters, Berks County and Berks Community TV for the opportunity to talk to you today about the Chesapeake and what we're doing about it.
Excellent. So tell us a bit about your involvement with the Chesapeake Bay. Why do you care about the Chesapeake Bay?
Well, first, a little bit about my involvement. The Chesapeake Bay Program Office, where I work, we support and facilitate the collaborative process that brings all the partners together to restore and protect the Chesapeake Bay and its watershed. So the restoration process is really important for a number of reasons. It's environmentally important, economically important, quality of life is impacted by our ability to restore the Chesapeake. And we've made a lot of progress, and the more, but we have a lot more to go before we can reach our goals. You know, as a partnership, we're accelerating the pace of our activities and we're closing the gap, but we have a far way to go before we reach 2025. So we appreciate the opportunity to provide some history and background on our efforts and give you a sense for how we're moving forward. Why I care? I grew up on the river of the Chesapeake Bay program where I could fish, I could swim, I could sail, row my boat. I live right now on another river of the Chesapeake, and I want to ensure that my son and my son's children have a restored and protected bay so that he and his children can enjoy those same experiences.
Excellent. Can you give us an overview of the Chesapeake Bay historically?
Sure. So the Chesapeake Bay that we see today was formed by during the melting of the last ice age. So it's been around for a while. It really caused the flooding. It caused the Susquehanna to flood its banks and the Potomac and James and York rivers also. And that's where the Chesapeake comes from. It was mostly forested historically. It's the largest estuary in the country. Its watershed is 64,000 square miles. That includes not only Pennsylvania, but New York, Maryland, Virginia, West Virginia, Delaware, and the District of Columbia. It's shallow, its average is 21 feet, and making its land to water ratio about 14 to 1, which is the largest of any coastal waters in the world. And that's why the impacts, the things that we do on the land impact so much the waters of the Chesapeake. It's home to 3,600 species of plants and animals. It's important to flyways for waterfowl. It's critically important and rich in human history from indigenous people all the way back to Paleo Indians people in 9,500 BC to European settlers to the diversity of population that we have today. It's, it's the place where much of the Revolutionary War and the Civil War happened. And today we're home to more than 18 million people, three state capitals, Pennsylvania's, Maryland, and Virginia, and our nation's capital. It's important to the watershed's economy for fishing, agriculture, recreation, and tourism.
Excellent. Can you give us an overview of the environmental history of the Chesapeake Bay then?
Sure, and I can start in the 50s and 60s when we didn't have a good idea about the impact that we were having on the environment across the world. Things like DDT that were recognized in Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring, had a great impact on not only the environment across the world, but on the Chesapeake Bay specifically. And, one of the things that happened is it made the bay pretty vulnerable. So that in 1972, when Tropical Storm Agnes came through, it really caused an impact on how many acres of underwater grasses there were. And this, along with the rapid loss of aquatic and wildlife, led the U.S. Senator from Maryland, Mac Mathias, to sponsor a five-year study that led to the Chesapeake Bay Program. So that study found that there was an overabundance of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment. There was a loss of underwater grasses as critical habitat for fish and shellfish, and there was a problem with chemical contaminants. And so the Chesapeake Bay Program Partnership began with an agreement signed by the governors of Pennsylvania, Maryland, Virginia, the DC mayor, the administrator for EPA, and the Chesapeake Bay Commission, which is a tri-state legislative body that predated the Chesapeake Bay Program. And the first agreement was signed in 1983, and that was just an agreement where we agreed to shake hands and work together. And since then, we've had a lot of new agreements and more sophisticated until today. The last agreement was signed in 2014. And not only were the original signatories signed it, but the governors of New York, Delaware, and West Virginia were included on the signature of that, that agreement. And it commits to 10 goals, 31 outcomes, not only focusing on water quality, so it's also focusing on habitat, sustainable fisheries, conserved lands, environmental education, among other things.
What is the economic history of the Chesapeake Bay?
Well, that also is a pretty pretty broad and diverse story, but it in terms of on the water itself, commercial and recreational fishing are really extremely important. Things like oysters, crabs, striped bass, shad, and trout in the fresher waters have always been important to the region's economy and at risk for pollution and habitat degradation. Agriculture plays a huge part in our regional economy, as does tourism. In fact, the outdoor recreation provides over $3 billion in state and local revenue across the watershed. And fishing license sales in Pennsylvania contributed to $37 million in state and local tax revenue. So it's the outdoor recreation and fishing are really important to the economy of this whole area.
So who allows pollution to continue in the Chesapeake Bay and why? Who's helped by polluting and who's hurt by polluting?
So the short answer to that question is we all do. We all impact the pollution in the bay. The tricky part about nitrogen, phosphorus, nutrients is that the right amount is not only okay, but it's really important for life. So nutrients, it's important for our crops. It's important for our gardens. It's important for our bodies. But it's too much of a good thing is what leads us to nutrient pollution. And so each of us and how many of us there are, there are 11 or there are 18 million people in this watershed, contribute to the pollution, particularly nitrogen and phosphorus pollution through our sewage, through the manure of the animals that feed us, through the fertilization of our lawns and gardens. Again, a little bit is a good thing, but too much is what causes the major pollution in our bay.
So do we have a good feel for what businesses or what areas are accounting for the greater amount of pollution going in? I mean, is it a lot of lawn chemicals from homes, or is it more agricultural chemicals or businesses, or where do you think it's mostly?
Well, it's coming from a lot of different places. It's pretty diffuse, but our watershed has quite a bit of agriculture in it, and agriculture does contribute a lot of excess nutrients and sediment. But in addition to that, it's our wastewater treatment plants. It's our stormwater, our the runoff from rain. It's our cars. It's driving our cars. It's the way we get energy. So it's quite diffuse how we where it all comes from.
So that reminds me of the comic. We have met the enemy, and he is us.
Yes,
we're creating our own problems, and then we're trying to find solutions.
Well, the good news to that is that because it's us, we are in control of the solution as well.
Excellent point. what changes are occurring from about Chesapeake Bay from a national level, state level, local levels? What are you seeing change and how is that impacting?
So a couple of areas of stronger emphasis very recently have come to the Chesapeake Bay program, as well as at the national, state, and local levels. One of them is ensuring that we have diversity, equity, inclusion, and justice within our program. And because of that, our executive council, which are our governors and our administrator, signed a pledge last year about improving our diversity, equity, inclusion, and justice in our program. The other place is climate change. And, you know, we are working really hard on all different areas of restoring and protecting the Bay, climate change and how we adapt to it and how we stay resilient to it is another area that we are taking quite seriously and have increased the our focus and attention on it. And the Chesapeake Bay program, we're hoping that we are going to be having a stronger focus in the near term. A couple of other things that I would say about the national level. We have an EPA administrator, Michael Regan, who during his congressional hearings for his appointment has specifically expressed a strong interest and commitment to the Bay and in putting his money where his mouth is. The president also has a fiscal 2022 budget that would deliver $90.5 million to the Bay program. And if that full amount were provided to us, it would be $3 million increase. And most of that goes to the states and locals for implementation.
You mentioned climate change, and there's been a lot of discussion about the heat wave on the West Coast and all these other issues throughout the country and the world. Are you seeing specific things in the Chesapeake Bay related to climate change that you could talk about, whether it's changes in water temperature or other related to that?
We are seeing different some changes that could be attributable to climate change. The rainfall the storm events are harsher, stronger than they used to be, and that causes a lot of increased runoff in the Chesapeake. Sea level rise is a concern. We have a lot of sunny day flooding in some of our coastal waters, coastal cities like Norfolk and Annapolis, where the sea level rise is causing, the tides are causing flooding in the streets, even on sunny days. The water temperatures, it could be attributed to climate change, but the past couple of years we've had some pretty warm water temperatures in the Bay.
And you also mentioned DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion. Mm-hmm. How is that implementing, or how is that affecting anything that you're doing or that other folks are doing in terms of protecting the Chesapeake Bay?
Well, and that's a really good question, but I think that one of the main things that I would say is that when you look at the diversity within our watershed, it's not reflected in the management and leadership of our program and a lot of our environmental organizations, which means that we don't have the value of different diverse thinking in terms of our solutions. So that's one of the areas. The other area is environmental justice. So we want to make sure that when we're doing restoration activities, that we're doing them equally and fairly across communities, and not having a community that's disadvantaged, not getting the focus and attention it should.
What kind of restorations are you doing? How does that take place?
So the partnership in general, so the Chesapeake Bay Program Office typically provides funding to and grants to the states, as well as to an organization called the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, where we provide funds for innovative nutrient and sediment reduction grants, I know that six of the 11 that we just announced for $10 million are in Pennsylvania. We also provide $7 million of most effective basins funding, which means that we focus our attention on the areas that are going to be most likely to positively impact the restoration of the bay. And Pennsylvania received the largest share of that. So it's for things that, it's for activities that that help us restore the bay. It might be for cover crops and agricultural lands to make sure that those soils don't remain bare during the winter. It could be on manure storage areas. It could be on stormwater management or wastewater treatment. But all of those things are things that we help fund. The states put in a large part of that budget, as do local governments. So it truly is a partnership, but those are the activities that we typically used to restore the bay.
Pennsylvania is one of the states in this consortium. Mm-hmm. And I understand there's guidelines for how the states are supposed to improve things, ameliorate things. Is Pennsylvania complying with what it's supposed to be doing?
So this one of the things that I would say is that for the Chesapeake Bay Program Partnership, we have something overall called a pollution diet. It's called a total maximum daily load, but really it's a pollution diet that provides targets to each of the states and DC in the watershed. They then develop watershed implementation plans and two-year milestones. These plans are put in place specifically to meet the targets by 2025. Pennsylvania's watershed implementation plan gets them about 75% of the way there, but they have committed to doing a new watershed implementation plan by the end of the year. So that will target the rest of the, that will reach the target. I would say also, though, that those are the plans, but there's a long way to go, short time to get there, and it's a big lift, and it's a particularly big lift for Pennsylvania because their targets are higher, their pollution reduction targets are higher than any of the other jurisdictions.
I'm sorry, I want to make sure I heard you correctly. You called that a pollution diet?
Yes.
Okay, interesting terminology.
Yes, well, you know, like when people go on diets, it's because they're eating too much, and with the bay, they are getting too much nutrients, and so we're trying to put them on a diet so that it will have a healthy weight.
Fascinating. How can normal citizens get involved in this, especially Pennsylvania, especially Berks County?
There's a lot of things that normal citizens can do. This is, you know, this is what I said earlier when I said that you know, the problem is ours, the solution is also ours. So if you own a house and if you own property, you can control the stormwater on your property. You can use rain barrels on your gutters. You can use rain gardens using native plants, all of that. If you don't own a house, or even if you do, you can drive less. The nitrogen in the air, the nitrogen and oxide in the air, driving is a big problem with that. So drive less, clean up after your dog. When you walk your dog, clean up after your dog. Use less fertilizer, don't litter. These are all simple things that are good for the environment, regardless of whether you're in the Chesapeake Bay watershed or not. But really having a smaller footprint is really what we're talking about. If you want to do more, there's watershed organizations pretty much everywhere. Join a watershed organization, and they usually have planned activities so that you can join a larger group and cleaning up litter or doing citizen monitoring or any of those other things.
Are there any questions that I haven't asked you that I should be asking you about? Anything that we don't want to overlook in terms of Chesapeake?
I think that one of the main things for me is that water quality is important, and we put an emphasis on it, but there are other things that we're looking to do in the Chesapeake Bay program. The agreement has 10 different goals, only one of which is water quality. So there's 9 other goals, and there's 31 different outcomes. And there are things like land conservation, habitat restoration, education, all of those are really important outcomes as well, because if we don't do all of them together, sustainable fisheries, making sure that we're doing well with fisheries management, all of that is important if we're really going to restore the bay and its watershed. And I think that a lot of people, in particular in Pennsylvania, are upstream from the tidal waters of the Chesapeake. And so they may not worry about oysters and crabs so much, but anything that they do on their land and in their waters is improving their land and waters. So I guess I would really encourage that, that there's a lot of things going on in the Chesapeake Bay watershed and what we're trying to accomplish, and anything that you can do on your land and in your waters will certainly benefit downstream, but will also benefit you. I think that the other thing that I would say is that while we are making great progress, and we are making great progress, we have the largest, most successful oyster restoration in the world right now. We have a sustainable blue crab population. Our water quality is at near record highs. Our land conservation efforts, it's really close to where the Biden administration's commitment to protect 30% of the U.S. lands by 2030. We're pretty close to that, very proud of that. So there's a lot of things that are going on beyond our water quality improvements, and really encourage people to get involved with anything.
Excellent. Now, I've got one question that I've heard about a bit lately, and that's about the songbirds. There's concern locally about, I don't know how widespread this is, about songbirds being impacted by some kind of disease. Is that something you're hearing about with relationship to Chesapeake Bay?
No, I am not. I'm not hearing much about that. I do know that songbirds have a relationship with the size of the forests that we have, and our lands are historically forested, but the more interior forests that are available, the healthier those birds are going to be. So I don't know what's impacting them specifically, but I do know that to keep them resilient, it's always good to have good habitat for them.
Are there some websites that you can recommend to our viewers to get more information about this?
Well, I'm going to tout our own partnerships website. The www.chesapeakebay.net is an excellent website for information across what the issues are, what we're doing about it, the history of the Chesapeake. A lot of the questions that I just barely touched on, those are things that you would find in great detail on that. It also has a calendar of events for any work groups or board meetings that anybody would want to attend. They're open to the public. The other website is www.chesapeakeprogress.com. That will tell you how well we're doing against all of the commitments that we have. So it has for each of the outcome, each of the 31 outcomes, we have something that says what we're doing and how well we're doing.
Excellent. Well, Carin, thank you very much for joining us today to talk to us about the Chesapeake Bay. I hope that we get a chance. Excuse me, get a chance to talk further about this. I'm hoping to stop down there sometime and check out the bird activity on the Chesapeake Bay. That seems like that would be a great thing to do.
You are very welcome to do that.
Excellent. Okay, well, Carin, thank you again for joining us. And hopefully, I think we have 2 additional guests who should be coming on in a minute. So, Carin, I'm going to give you a sitting ovation. And I think we're connecting our other speakers right now.
Okay. Bye.
Bye, Carin. Hello. So I'd like to introduce my second and third guests. Harry Campbell is with the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, Pennsylvania Science Policy and Advocacy Director. Mr. Campbell has over 20 years of experience in watershed assessment, restoration, and protection science policy and advocacy, and has worked in nonprofit, academia, for-profit, and government entities. He has a Bachelor of Science in Environmental Resource Management and a Master's degree in Environmental Pollution Control with an emphasis in organic chemistry and ecotoxicity from Pennsylvania State University. I'm just glad I was able to say that without stumbling. That's a lot, Harry. And Bill Wenger is the president and CEO of the Lancaster Conservancy. Phil was a local business restaurant owner who founded a restaurant chain familiar to many in Berks County called Isaac's. They have a location in Spring Ridge. As a Lancaster County community leader, he changed careers at the end of 2015 and joined the Lancaster Conservancy as its president. Phil has served in multiple community leadership posts, including healthcare and economic development, but wanted to leave a larger impact on the community and the Susquehanna River that he loves. So he left retirement to lead a team to protect this landscape and watershed during his tenure. Well, I don't want to say that because I want you to say that during the discussion. So welcome to both of you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you. Pleasure to be here.
It is.
So Phil, I'll start with you. Tell me about your involvement with the Chesapeake Bay. Why do you care?
Well, the Chesapeake Bay has been a decades-long effort to deal with this waterway that has had many challenges. But Pennsylvania, the stem of the Susquehanna River, is one of the single largest pollutants of phosphates and sediment and nitrogen that flow into the bay. And so here in Lancaster County, which is just south of Berks County, we have made it a community-wide priority to address the water that flows through Lancaster County and ends up in the Susquehanna River, which goes down and impacts the Chesapeake Bay. And so our organization really has focused on that. And so we look at all of these wooded tracts of land that are along our streams and rivers, and we fight hard to protect those. We work with a lot of landowners, and we plant a lot of trees along those waterways. And we really, really, really want to make for sure that we're doing what we can around water. And so for us, the issue is clean water, and clean water always flows downstream, and that has a huge impact on the bay, where Harry is really the expert on the Chesapeake Bay cleanup. So I'll let him talk about that for a minute.
Harry, that sounds like an introduction for you. Go ahead.
Well, you know, the reason why I care, and I think many of us do care, is because it's about our health, our well-being, and our quality of life. It is the desire to leave a lasting legacy of clean water, healthy air, and productive soils for this and future generations that we work and strive to not only restore in the health and condition of the Chesapeake Bay, but the rivers and streams that feed into it. The Susquehanna River is the largest source of freshwater and unfortunately the largest source of nitrogen pollution affecting the Chesapeake Bay. And so we toil here in the Chesapeake Bay, Pennsylvania office on trying to work with communities, landowners, producers, a whole myriad of entities, local governments and others, to do the right thing, to protect and restore the water quality that is feeding into the Chesapeake Bay for our health, well-being, and economic vitality. And personally, it's not just about the bay.
Yep.
To me, it's about the lake I grew up on, that I spent hours fishing with my father and my best friend. It's about the woods I wandered aimlessly as a young kid, learning not only about the environment, but about myself and who I wanted to become. And it was about the places and the people that I care about, the communities I live in, my family and my children, and the lasting legacy that is so critically important to this endeavor. So while we talk about it in the context of the Chesapeake Bay, it is really about each and every one of us in our individual lives, the health and well-being and quality of life of our friends and family and our communities.
That was very moving from both of you. Thank you very much for sharing that. Can you give us an overview of the Susquehanna and the Chesapeake historically in terms of how things evolved there? Harry, you want to start?
Yeah, sure. You know, quite frankly, prior to the ending of the last ice age, called the Pleistocene Epoch, about 12,000 years ago, there was no Chesapeake Bay. In fact, what there was what would become the Susquehanna River, or be called the Susquehanna River, what would be ultimately become the Atlantic Ocean. But with the ending of that last ice age, the sea level started to rise. Those nooks and crannies of the shoreline, which make up over 11,000 miles of shoreline within the Chesapeake Bay, started to form and create a function and an ecosystem that it was frankly beyond compare. And as a result of that, and the battle between that fresh and salt water, when Captain John Smith in 1608 laid eyes on the Chesapeake Bay for the first time, he declared that no other place known to man was as perfect for human habitation as the Chesapeake Bay, or what would become called the Chesapeake Bay. But the thing about it is that for thousands of years prior to Captain John Smith taking a look at the Chesapeake Bay, there were Native Americans living within the watershed as well. Over 30 tribes, actually, and thousands of, in terms of population, lived within the Chesapeake Bay watershed, relying upon its production for their food sources, their culture, and what would be considered their economy as well. And so we have inherited that, if you will, and changed it, of course, over the course of time as it pertained to colonialization, industrialization, which we can touch upon later. But the history of the Chesapeake Bay is such that forming about 12,000 years ago and becoming what is known as the most productive estuary ever to known who have existed, with a unique land to water ratio. No other watershed in the estuary in the world has a land to water ratio as large as the Chesapeake Bay. And what that means is that what we do on the land has a profound significance and impact on the Chesapeake Bay. So really interesting stuff. And I'm sure Phil can fill in as it pertains to some other neat little tidbits about the bay as well.
Yeah, so I've spent a lot of time on the bay, both sailing out of Annapolis and, you know, spending a lot of time, spending weekends down there. And I can attest for the salt water and the experience there. But my real love comes above Harbor de Grace as the Susquehanna flows up through York and Lancaster counties. And eventually, you know, some of the creeks from Berks County feed right into the Chesapeake Bay. And I can tell you that, you know, in just my lifetime, the population of this area has almost tripled. You know, when my father was born here in 1918, it was 1.8 billion residents in the world. Today, there's 7.6 billion. And the same thing has happened here in the East Coast, and people are naturally attracted to water. So what has happened is, you know, this river for many years was the source of commerce. It was the source of food, and it was used and abused by everybody who was attracted to it. And so what happened over time is that people just came to the bay and did whatever they wanted to it. I'm so sorry. I don't know what happened there.
But I was hoping that was on your end, Bill.
It was.
No one to turn off. Go ahead.
But people came to the bay and they used and abused this bay and they dumped all kinds of stuff into it. And so the cleanup effort actually started way back in the 60s when we sort of passed a major congressional act to make our major polluters, the ones who were putting heavy metals, the ones that were putting tons of chemicals, the ones that were basically taking their factories and discharging their wastewater directly into the river. And we made a concerted effort to get the pollutants that are incredibly harmful to human beings out of the water. But what we failed to do was look at the other sources of what makes quality water. And those are the things that we're now targeting through initiatives that we have right now. So human beings come along and they want to grow crops, and they want to spread nitrogen all over their lawns, and they want to put things down. And when the rain falls, all of that washes down into our streams. And that nitrogen, which makes grass turn green, goes into the bay, and it makes the whole ecosystem there go bananas. And so all of a sudden, you get these major algae blooms, and they take all the oxygen out of the water. And I'm not a scientist, but I know what a dead zone is, and I've actually kayaked into one where there's basically no life. There's no plant life. There's no insects that are, like, coming out of the water and feeding food for birds. There's no fish life. And we've seen these dead zones emerge as the population here in Pennsylvania and all around the Chesapeake Bay has increased. And so the states have all come together, you know, the states, there's six states that whose watersheds run into the Chesapeake Bay, and they've all come together and they said, we are going to change this. We're going to take the nitrogen levels from each of our communities and we're going to lower those. And then there's sediment that's the same thing because we had mill dams all over the place. There's like brown ditches that are many of our streams are in. And we said, we need to make sure that soil stays in place so that every time we get a big storm, like happened with all the way back to Agnes, we all remember that, but the major flooding events wash all this brown chocolate down into the bay. And when it settles on the dirt, it covers off everything, cuts off all the life, the shellfish, you know, our crabs go away, our oysters go away, the things that we love, but there's a whole rich biodiverse life on the bay. So we wanna keep that intact. So we're focused on that here in these communities to try and lower our nitrogen and the phosphorus that comes along with nitrogen because it's very much what is used in farming. And then we have this sediment. And so what we're working on now is trying to get the health of the bay back through its biodiversity. By that, people like glaze over. But when we talk about insects and birds, we talk about fish, people can understand that because we've just seen a decline of all of those species across the board. You know, we used to catch smallmouth bass right here on the Susquehanna, and the fishermen have almost given up. They just aren't there anymore. The water just is so heavily nitrogen, and we have all these storms that bring this chocolate water down here, and there's hardly any fish left. And the fish and the insects and the birds, we hear about the insect apocalypse here. You know, we don't get them on our cars when we drive around much anymore because there just aren't as many. And then it's the same with the birds. And so this is all very serious stuff, and the bay cleanup has to be linked to all that work. So anyway, I can go on and on, but you can tell this is all interconnected. The clean water is connected to what we care about, which is the beauty, the rich diversity of life that exists all around us.
So who allows, maybe allows is the wrong word, but who allows pollution to continue into the Chesapeake Bay and why? Are there businesses who are helped? Does it help a farmer to not do things properly in terms of avoiding the runoff? I mean, if their soil is running off into the stream, doesn't that hurt them?
You know, in my personal opinion, who allows that? We do. We as a society, in terms of our daily decisions, of where we buy our food, where we live, what we drive, who we vote for. These daily decisions end up determining in many ways whether or not we allow these things to occur, or at least where we invest our monies and resources into solving problems so as to allow farmers to keep soils and nutrients on the land instead of in the water, or to preserve iconic ecosystems and biodiverse areas, upland and riparian and in the water through conservation easements and other preservation initiatives. By each and every one of us making daily decisions over the course of time, they add up and result in farmers in a race to provide society lots of food cheaply are intensifying their agricultural activities. And in order to placate Americans' desires for big homes with lush green lawns, we're converting forest lands and wetlands and farm fields into subdivisions and strip malls. And we are ignoring or otherwise undervaluing our underground infrastructure and allowing for combined sewer overflows, which release raw sewage at certain times of the year and certain precipitation events throughout Pennsylvania and the Chesapeake Bay watershed and Susquehanna River as well. So each and every one of these little decisions that we make as individuals collectively result in the fact that the Chesapeake Bay has a dead zone on average. About 30% of the bottom layers are a dead zone each and every summer. the fact that over 25,000 miles of Pennsylvania's rivers and streams are considered impaired, not meeting water quality standards, some of which are devoid of all discernible aquatic life. These decisions result in these situations.
Yeah. I think a lot of us sort of maybe we're naively just sort of expecting that the government and the EPA or the DEP, Department of Environmental Protection here in Pennsylvania, or the EPA at the federal level, would just pass the laws and do all the enforcement required to make sure our waterways are clean. And while government plays a very key role in this, and we do need legislative support to take care of our water sources and to take care of our clean air, because we do share them between each other, there are private organizations like the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, like the Conservancy, like the Alliance to Save the Bay, who are really the voice piece of the movement to say we have to stop abusing the land and we have to take care of the water and the air. And we have to create something here that will sustain us for generations, as opposed to just completely end up just destroying everything that we have come to love and know as human beings. And so those private organizations motivate and energize folks. And then that turns into the army that goes back and really tries to make sure that the legislature is trying to make sure that they're keeping up with where we need to be. And I will tell you, this is the time in our lives when we see an opportunity to create change and we know we have only a window or so to do it, maybe a generation and a half. And between climate change and between population growth and between the decline of the natural world, we have one sort of opportunity here as human beings to come together and change. And we've seen it here at the Conservancy. We used to have several hundred supporters. Now we have thousands and thousands of supporters. We used to see people not caring, and they would go spray their herbicides right into the streams, killing off all the insects that the birds need to eat. And we see people now paying attention and stopping doing that. And then we hopefully will see government money. Now, you talked about the farmers, and I want to talk about them a little bit because they get a really bad rap. And farming practices have changed that have not been as ecologically driven. But for the farmers in Lancaster and York counties, and even in Berks County, most of them, if you talk to them, they want to do the right thing. They basically say to each other, we don't want to pollute the bay. But what we need is we need resources in order to be able to take those farms out of production. And we need resources to be able to make for sure that we can do the right thing with the land. And so we're always looking to help the farmer do the right thing because they want to, but they're struggling just like everybody else is to make a living.
Yeah. I've got a question I hadn't thought of until we started discussing this in this fashion. Who owns the land under the river? Who owns, as you're approaching a river and you get into the, do people actually, private landowners own up to a river or into the river, or how does that ownership work? Do you know?
I know just a little bit. But most of the rivers and creeks that are navigable are public land. And so they're owned by the municipality in which the stream flows through, and the municipality ends up with responsibility. Places like the Susquehanna River are unique in the fact that hundreds of years ago, they determined that York County starts at the western edge of the Susquehanna. So Lancaster County actually owns the land under the Susquehanna River that flows between Lancaster and York counties. And so when I touch the river and stand on that, I'm in Lancaster County, even though I'm on the York bank. But that's what I, in answer to your question.
So in terms of people utilizing right up to the river, typically that's public land there.
I was saying, the public land is land under the water. The private land is what comes right up to the river. And so we have to deal with private property owners. So farmers who are farming right up to the edges of the streams, we have to work with them and change their practices of how they deal with their stream banks. It's the same with businesses and, you know, their private property that is not only on the banks, but it's all the water that flows into the rivers that comes from their stormwater and managing that stormwater. And then it's all the private property who goes into that storm drain at the end of your street. You think it's gone, but actually that's the water that's in the stream. And so we've got to deal with those source pollutions. And it's not necessarily who owns the land under the water. That's not where the cleaning happens.
Correct. Yeah.
So in terms of the stormwater, What can property owners, what can citizens do to protect, to help try to protect, I mean, driveways and putting salt down for ice? What do we need to do to handle things better?
Well, there's a whole myriad of things that landowners can do. And really, it is almost like a choose your own adventure sort of scenario. But if you're talking about like what actually is the dominant sources of impairment that is affecting Pennsylvania's rivers and streams and ultimately the Chesapeake Bay, we got to do things that reduce the amount of nutrients and sediments that are entering into the lands and then going into the water. And so primarily for an individual landowner, that's about things like, you know, putting in rain barrels so as to capture rooftop runoff and holding it so it doesn't get into that storm sewer system or into the streets at a pace that's unnatural, that causes bed and bank erosion and shuttles pollution and garbage and bacteria down to the nearest receiving water body. And also causes and or exacerbates some of these combined sewer overflows, those raw sewage discharges that I was talking about earlier. It's about preserving and restoring tree cover, particularly alongside streams and streets. So if you happen to be in a place where you have the ability to plant a street tree, these are critically important to keeping water out of our storm sewer system, slowing it down, spreading it out, allowing it to infiltrate and evapotranspirate as opposed to go off into the nearest receiving water body as runoff. It's also things like what are called rain gardens. These are areas that are actually purposely designed areas to receive stormwater runoff that look like basically flowered gardens, but they are an engineered design system that allows for the infiltration, filtration, and evapotranspiration of stormwater runoff, maximizes the bacterial, physical, and chemical removal of pollutants, including toxic heavy metals and oils from these systems. And then finally, we also need to do things beyond our own backyard. We need to engage in our communities, talk to our neighbors, our local officials, our state and federal legislators, because these are the entities and individuals that are making decisions on a daily basis about the trajectory of our environment at a local, state, and regional level as well. And joining organizations like the Lancaster Conservancy, the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, and others will allow individuals to learn more about the things that they can do, how they can engage, and give people the education and tools and capacity to be impactful in these endeavors.
So I will just tell you that my number one thing I always tell people is plant trees. I mean, it's really that simple, because trees have so much more than stormwater. So they help the bay in an enormous way. They capture that stormwater and hold it up in the tree, so that it doesn't come gushing down and go off and wash out the neighbor's, you know, yard, okay? So trees are incredibly powerful, but they also clean the air and they also provide a great feeding source. So I tell people, get rid of your lawn and plant some trees. If you want to keep a lawn around the house, fine, but we drive by these houses that have 10 acres of lawn. And you know what they do with that lawn? They treat it with a lot of nitrogen right before it rains and that water washes off. Then they spray it with all kinds of chemicals that kill all the insects that make it basically a dead zone on land. And those dead zones on land that you just dump a lot of nitrogen on are very, very harmful to the ecosystem. And so I just say plant trees. They're so much easier. They provide shade. They cool. They take carbon out of the atmosphere and help with climate change. They do all these wonderful things. So, you know, I always used to laugh at the people that were like tree huggers and we get up there and keep a tree from getting cut down. But when I became a knowledgeable, I discovered that trees are so beneficial in so many different areas. I don't understand why somebody wants to have this huge lawn that they have to pay. Do you know the typical lawnmower tractor, you know, puts more pollutants into the air, you know, than 26 cars? I mean, it's incredibly polluting. It's incredibly toxic. And yet it is the status symbol that people have. The bigger the lawn, the greener the lawn, the more rich I must be. But you're destroying the environment, and we have to change that mindset in people if we really want to impact. And this is a thing that people can do right now. Get rid of half your lawn, stop the pollution, create more biodiversity, set that lawn aside for animals, creatures you share the planet with, and it'll also capture stormwater and clean the bay at the same time.
And it cools the air. It's dramatic differences in temperature under a tree than versus not. And given the recent heat wave we've had, I really liked walking my dog, and when we would see some shade, he did too. And those trees are critically important to that. So significant are the impact of trees that it's a the tree-based practices are the number one practice Pennsylvania is relying upon to achieve its Chesapeake Bay goals and obligations. And in fact, the Chesapeake Bay Foundation coordinates an entity of over 100 organizations, including the Lancaster Conservancy, on what is known as the Keystone 10 Million Trees Partnership, an endeavor to plant 10 million native trees alongside Pennsylvania stream streets and other high priority areas by the end of 2025. Joining that endeavor as well, we provide free trees and technical and logistical support to individual landowners, producers, and municipalities to get that job done.
Yep, there's free trees if you want them. Just you can contact any one of a number of organizations. Just write free trees up in your Google search and you can do that. But for other folks too, I went to the Conservation District in Berks County. I went to there, what can I do in my backyard? And there's literally a list of 20 things that you can do there. Everything, you know, from the rain barrels to starting a compost pile to basically planting vegetative that is native. All of these really do affect water quality. And I could, you know, there's a lot of studies that support that kind of work. More power to anybody that really wants to care about our planet. And you know, the funny thing is climate change is affecting all of us. It's affecting the bay, it's affecting vegetation, it's affecting our future. And people always feel so powerless when it comes to climate change. And I always say, you can do your part to stop climate change just by going out and planting some backyard trees. You know, seriously, they don't all have to be street trees. You don't have to get special permission from the city and pull a permit in order to be able to do that. Just plant a tree in your backyard and you will do an awful lot to affect climate change. And so I'm a huge fan of that. And I preach it a lot because our organization saves trees that are already there by acquiring those trees and trying to care for them. Because, Lancaster County, for instance, is only about 14%. With trees. That's all we've got. We've got one of the fewest tree covers in any county in Pennsylvania. And it's critical that we protect those because as farms have been protected, they're moving more and more into creating housing developments with our few remaining forested hills. And you see that all over Berks County. Wherever there's a hill, you see the houses go up and then you see the trees disappear over time. And those developments sort of are doing a lot of harm to the community. So we think those mature forests that exist should probably be protected. And you have a conservancy, you have Berks Nature, who just got a huge grant, who's been doing environmental education that is now gonna be moving into doing more land protection. And I encourage you to get them on here another time just to talk about those issues of protecting all of those trees in Berks County that still exist.
It sounds like I want to give you an opportunity, Phil, to talk about what you're doing on the ground in Lancaster and York counties, because I know you've done quite a bit conservation of different sites.
We're very special. We are a land trust. That means we find forested tracts of land that are natural and we actually go out and acquire them. We buy them with some state grants and private money, and then we rehabilitate them. In other words, we go in and we create bird and bat habitat and we restore them, but we then also open them for recreation. So you can come out and hunt, you can fish, and you can get away and escape, particularly during years like COVID when everybody wants to go into nature for their mental health and their physical health. So that's what we're doing. We've got 45 miles of trails, 47 nature preserves, and we operate those for the public benefit. And that's what we do.
Well, it sounds like you are both extremely passionate about what you're involved in. And I think that comes across very well to the public. Are there any questions that I haven't asked you that I should be asking you? Anything that, any deep dark secrets about conservation or tree hugging that people might want to know about? Is there a proper way to hug a tree?
Any way you so desire. It's better to hug one than to cut one down. But I think, you know, at the end of the day, it is really, if people are interested in these sort of things, there's just a plethora of resources. Technical folks, passionate folks that are really willing to come out and individually work with individual landowners, producers, and others. Bill talked about his organization. We have a field staff that is out working with farmers to restore the health condition of their soils and repairing corridors as well. But there's just a plethora of opportunities for anyone who's interested to get involved in these sort of things. And to be honest with you, if you are a person who eats food, drinks water, and breathes the air, these issues are critically important to you and your family. And I don't know anybody who doesn't do at least one or two of those three things. And so it is critically important that people get involved and otherwise engage in these issues, because many hands make light work. These issues sound really tough and challenging, like climate change, but collectively, people are powerful. And the more people that get involved and engaged, the more successful we will be as a society for health, well-being, and quality of life.
I just want to do a shout out to the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. I mean, these guys are the leaders. I was on their website just a little while today, and there are so many resources there to answer so many questions about why the bay cleanup is important and what you can do. I just really shout them out, because their resource is really, really important, and their website's spectacular. Chesapeake Bay Foundation.
Excellent. Okay, well, gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us today. And I'm hopeful that we'll get the word out there and people will reach out to the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, Lancaster and Berks Conservancies, and other opportunities to get involved and hug a tree, plant a tree, try to avoid big dead areas with fertilizer and chemicals and killing everything that we can. So thank you very much for joining us. And I'm going to, in closing, give a little shout out to the League of Women Voters, which I'm a representative of. The League is a 100-year-old plus nonpartisan political organization encouraging informed and active participation in government. We influence public policy through education and advocacy, holding events like BCTV shows on Chesapeake Bay. We never support or oppose any political candidate or party. We are political but nonpartisan. We do study issues, develop consensus opinions, and actively work to support those positions. So if you want to consider joining the League of Women Voters of Berks County or the League of Women Voters in other counties or other states. And thank you very much for joining us, Philip Wenger and Harold Campbell. Harold, right? Harry.
Good. Harry.
Either one.
And I will hopefully talk to you gentlemen again soon. I'll try to stop down to the Susquehanna or the Chesapeake and wave as I study the birds flying around. Thank you very much. And good night.
Thank you, Bill.
It's a joy. Thank you.